There are lots of ways to think. And what you want is you want a toolkit of ways to think, and you want ways to think to be aligned with the problems you're thinking about. So we talk about sort of four examples of ways of thinking. There's engineering thinking, which is very prevalent in modern society because of our technical society. And engineers solve tame problems to which there are clear, repeatable solutions. Once I figure out how to build the Brooklyn Bridge, I can build it again and again. It'll work every time. That's a hard problem, but it's a tame problem. It's well-behaved. It'll act tomorrow just like it acted today. Business problems, you use optimization thinking. There's no right answer to your branding, no right answer to your market share, but you can optimize, and that's a different kind of thinking. Researchers do analytic thinking. They start with a premise, they thin slice it down, they've got a questioning process. Those are ways of thinking. What we call wicked problems, that's a technical term developed by some urban planners at Berkeley back in the 70s. A wicked problem is one where the criteria for success are unclear, constantly changing. You won't know you got the right answer until you find it, and once you found it, you can't reuse it again. You can't rebuild New York City somewhere else. You can't be Dave Evans again. You can't be somebody else again. So wicked problems are inherently human problems, and they're messy problems, and they're trying to intersect a future that none of us knows enough about. So how do you do that? You can't analyze that. So you build your way forward. In design, we build our way forward. And we build our way forward by sneaking up on the future through this iteration of prototypes. Get curious, ask a question, understand it, try something, learn something, do it again, till you get enough of an idea that you can implement and actually solve a problem. Okay, we have two kinds of prototyping, engineering prototypes and design prototypes. Now, I should also clarify, every time I say the word design here, I mean design as in design thinking, or technically human-centered design. The design program at Stanford was formed in the 60s. It's over 54 years old. It's the eldest interdisciplinary program at the university. The marriage of art, human factors, and mechanical engineering is actually located in the ME department, so where we technically work. And that design was conceived as an innovation methodology, not as craft. Most designers in the world were trained in the craft of design. Graphic designers can draw and lay things out, and industrial designers can shape things. Even ergonomic designers can shape things in a particular kind of a way. Stanford designers do design thinking. And design thinking is a methodology. It's not reliant upon craft, and so it's highly transferable. So when I talk about a design prototype, I mean a design thinking prototype. Engineers prototype things to prove that that tame solution to that tame problem they figured out does in fact work correctly. So if I'm going to, I actually have a master's in thermosciences, haven't used it much, but there you go. I used to know how to calculate a flame speed and design a turbine engine. So if I'm going to design a turbine engine, I'm General Electric, I'm going to run prototypes, you know, in a big soundproof cinder block, you know, box, so when it blows up, people don't get hurt. And prototype one and prototype two and prototype three are different variations on the turbine blades on this big fan that spins 100,000 RPM, and we're going to make sure that it works under stress conditions, and if it breaks, we're going to make a modification, we're going to get that engineering done right. That's engineering prototyping to prove that the idea I had works correctly. Because I already think I know what the answer is. A design prototype is not to prove my end solution right, it's to find out what I want to do in the first place. So an engineering prototype starts with a conclusion. A design prototype starts with a curiosity. So when we do prototyping and design, like, what do I want to know more about? Well, I can either think about that or I could try it. So this is the empirical embodied experience of going out and trying things. So for instance, when I was prototyping when I was the first mouse product manager at Apple many, many years ago, we prototyped the mouse. Now, the mouse was, of course, an electromechanical device. It had this little ball, and it had, you know, Schmidt trigger LED detectors in it that were brand new technology, and those things could be engineering prototyped. But whether or not you liked the way it felt in your hand, or rolling this thing around on the desk and then looking at the screen over there made sense to you, we had no idea how that was going to go. We had hundreds of prototypes, one button or two. I had long and religiously, ideologically animated conversations with Larry Tesler and Steve Jobs about one button or two and modelessness and double clicking. And, you know, there's no answer to those questions. You have to try them. So we did lots and lots of prototypes of process or experience and lots of prototypes of shape and what have you. And we ended up with the mouse and the mini mice we have today. Couldn't have engineered that. We had to design that. We want an example of a life prototype. So there's a woman we know, actually an example, who didn't do much prototyping. We'll call her Ellen, and she was an HR executive but loved Italian food and had always dreamed of having an Italian deli. And she decided to go for it. So she went for it. So she saw this old deli that was for sale, she bought it, she quit her job, she refurbished the whole thing, she redesigned it, she laid it out, she put in a little cafe because she wanted to replicate this experience she'd had living in Tuscany briefly, and it opened to great fanfare and was wonderfully successful. Nobody's successful the first time in a restaurant. Never happens. Except she hated it. She loved the idea of it, she loved developing it, and now I'm running a retail establishment. I have to hire people all the time. Most of my employees are high school kids and they quit on you regularly. I'm managing inventory lists. None of the reality of running an Italian deli and cafe was really delightful to her. Now, the prototypes that she could have iterated, she could have started with visiting a lot of different Italian cafes and talking to the owner. She could have gotten a job as a bus girl, actually waiting on tables, you know, enough to be a waiter, because they're sort of be trained, but I can clear the tables and overhear the conversations and see if people are having as good a time as I think they will in my place. I could try catering on a weekend. I could cater my friend's daughter's wedding. That's not a very big commitment. No capital is outlaid. Do I really want to cook that much? Lots of ways to try before you jump off the cliff or buy the farm, and that will give you feedback about what the reality really is. What prototypes in design do are they allow you to ask interesting questions, learn things, expose your assumptions, and let you sneak up on the future. So prototyping is a great way to go for your life because nobody knows the answer.